All right. Welcome, everyone. My name is Adam Levine, and I'm director of our Center for Human Rights and Humanitarian Studies here at the Watson Institute for International and Public Affairs. And I'm pleased to present what will be the last of our dialogue series this year on human rights and humanitarianism in action. And to get us started with this particular event, I am very pleased to introduce our visiting fellow, Agnieszka Rozinska, who will be leading the panel that we have for you today and acting as moderator. So Agnieszka joined us a year ago as a visiting fellow, and this actually marks the end of her time with us. And it's been incredible to have her expertise and insight all year long at our Center for Human Rights and Humanitarian Studies. She herself is a human rights specialist who is a true pracademic, straddling the worlds of both academia and practitioners in human rights. She has worked for a number of large human rights organizations, including Amnesty International Mexico and the Executive Secretariat of the National Human Rights Network, All Rights for All. And she's also worked as a consultant and a researcher, conducting research in human rights, mostly in her native Mexico and also in other parts of Latin America. She's been a real joy and a pleasure to have at our center this year. We're going to miss her a lot. And on behalf of the center, I want to say thank you to her. Without further ado, I will turn it over to Agnieszka so she can introduce our wonderful panel and we can get started with today's event. Thank you all.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for this kind introduction, Adam. And thank you for joining us today for our last panel discussion of the dialogue series on human rights and humanitarianism in action. I'm pleased to see people joining us from the US and Mexico and other regions for this session. It's a pleasure to have such diverse audience today. So today we will be discussing disappearances in transitional Latin America, and specifically the case of Mexico. And this is a topic that is very relevant and at the same, a very painful chapter in Mexico's modern history. And today we have two exceptional speakers with us. And it's my pleasure to present Dr. Karina Anzola-Bere, who is a researcher at the Institute of Legal Research of the National Autonomous University of Mexico and part-time researcher at Flaxo Mexico. Dr. Anzola-Bere is currently the principal investigator of the Observatory on Disappearances and Impunity in Mexico. She has multiple publications and most recent, a handbook of law and society in Latin America. On the other hand, Dr. Barbara Frey, she's a senior lecturer in the Institute for Global Studies and directs the Human Rights Program at the University of Minnesota. Dr. Frey is a principal investigator also with the Observatory on Disappearances and Impunity in Mexico. So both of them will be discussing their ongoing collaborative effort to systematically investigate, analyze, and combat patterns of impunity regarding enforced disappearances in Mexico. I would also, before we start, like to mention that this event is being organized with the co-sponsorship of the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies at Brown University. And as Adam already said, this will be the final event of our dialogue series on human rights and humanitarianism. This dialogue series has been organized by myself and my colleague Brittany Card as part of our fellowship at the Center of Human Rights and Humanitarian Studies. And it has been a real pleasure to collaborate with the center during this fellowship. Lastly, a couple of practical informations for this session. Both speakers will have about 15 minutes to present their research and share ideas for further discussion. And after that, we will have time for questions. We ask you to write your questions as our speakers present, and we will share them with Barbara and Karina at the end. And also, we are very happy to have the opportunity to provide interpretation for those who need it. Karina will be presenting in Spanish, so if you need interpretation, please click the interpretation feature below at your screens. And Barbara will present in English, so vice versa. And thank you. A lot of thanks to our interpreter for today. Patty is here with us, and thank you very much for the service you're providing. So I will stop here and let Karina start with the presentation. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Agnieszka, muchas gracias, Adam, Seth, y el Centro de Derechos Humanos y Humanitarianismo de la Universidad de Brown. Es un gran honor para mí poder estar y compartir parte del trabajo que realizamos en el Observatorio sobre Desaparición e Impunidad en México. También es un gran gusto compartir esta mesa con mi colega y amiga, querida amiga Barbara Fry, con quien hemos estado hace muchos años que colaboramos y en concreto hace más de 5 años que venimos trabajando en conjunto el tema de las desapariciones en México, específicamente las desapariciones que están sucediendo y que suceden a partir de 2006, del inicio de la denominada guerra contra el narcotráfico. Así que muchas gracias por esta posibilidad. Y voy a compartir pantalla para ser estricta con el tiempo. Bueno, yo en primer lugar quiero presentarles muy brevemente, dar un panorama sobre la dinámica de las desapariciones en México en los últimos años, entre 1964 y 2018, pero específicamente entre 2006 y 2018, para dar cuenta de la crisis de desapariciones en la que estamos insertas. Luego voy a compartir con ustedes una reflexión que hemos realizado juntamente con Bárbara y Lee Payne, la colega de la Universidad de Oxford, con quien también estudiamos en el observatorio, acerca de las lógicas de estas desapariciones que observamos y que elementos permiten que sigan sucediendo. Y finalmente quiero presentarles los resultados de la última etapa de investigación del observatorio vinculados con las respuestas estatales frente a las desapariciones o a este tipo de desapariciones. Bueno, en primer lugar, sobre las dinámicas de las desapariciones. Esta gráfica es una gráfica que a nosotros nos parece muy importante. ¿Qué nos indica esta gráfica? Bueno, que las desapariciones no son algo nuevo en México. ¿no? Desde 1964 a hoy, de acuerdo con el registro oficial de personas desaparecidas y no localizadas, se tiene registro de personas desaparecidas en el país. Pero sin embargo, entre 1964 y 206, este registro asciende a 1.867 personas. Y entre 2007 y 2018, el número asciende a 52.238 personas desaparecidas. Esto es, a partir de 2007, lo que observamos es un incremento exponencial de las desapariciones que tienen lugar en nuestro país. A partir de este incremento exponencial que tiene como punto de partida la denominada guerra contra el narcotráfico, iniciada durante la presidencia de Felipe Calderón, que se orientó a combatir militarmente a los cárteles de la droga, es el momento en que se detona este aumento de las desapariciones, y esto nos parecía importante para resaltar la situación en la que nos encontramos hoy en día. Ayer revisé el Registro Nacional sobre Desapariciones y al día de ayer hay casi 89.000 personas desaparecidas en México. Esto es, entre 2018 y hoy hay 30.000 personas más desaparecidas registradas en México. Esto es un problema muy importante. Yo aquí quiero mostrarles cómo ha evolucionado las desapariciones. Para esto, pensar en las dinámicas de las desapariciones, lo que encontramos es que las desapariciones no se mueven de manera homogénea en el tiempo, sino que hay momentos en que observamos picos de desapariciones y otros en que hay hay mayor estabilidad en el número. Y lo que en esta gráfica está pintado de amarillo son las desapariciones de mujeres, y lo que está pintado en azul son las desapariciones de hombres. En general, en México desaparecen personas, hombres y mujeres jóvenes de nivel socioeconómico bajo, y las mujeres que desaparecen son más jóvenes que los hombres. Y algo interesante o algo que nos sugiere esta gráfica es que como les señalaba, a partir de 2007 comenzamos a observar un incremento relevante de las desapariciones, pero que a partir de 2015 también observamos un incremento no solo de las desapariciones de hombres, sino también de las desapariciones de mujeres. Y hoy en varios de los estados de México, la proporción de mujeres y hombres desaparecidos son equivalentes. Bueno, todo esto para mostrarles un panorama, ¿no?, de la situación que estamos viviendo. Una de las preguntas que nos hemos hecho en el Observatorio sobre Desaparición e Impunidad es si estas desapariciones vinculadas con la guerra contra el narcotráfico, con estas características de violencia que ahora me voy a referir, que no solo están perpetradas por agentes estatales, sino que están perpetradas por una multiplicidad de actores, eran diferentes de lo que Gabriel Gatti, por ejemplo, refiere como desapariciones clásicas, aquellas formas de desaparición de las dictaduras militares que tuvieron lugar durante las dictaduras militares en el Cono Sur, en Argentina, en Chile. Y aquí encontramos, vamos, tres posiciones. Algunas que dicen que pues no son nuevas estas desapariciones, son una extensión de aquellas formas de desaparición que originalmente que tuvieron lugar en el Cono Sur y que pues simplemente estas desapariciones que observamos hoy son una, tienen que ver con nuevas formas de ejercicio de la dominación y que en realidad encontramos una continuidad entre ambas formas. Hay trabajos que plantean que estas desapariciones son fenómenos nuevos, ¿no? Que en realidad no tienen, no están vinculadas con, remiten a otras dinámicas, a otras condiciones, incluso a otras intencionalidades, y no están vinculadas con las desapariciones clásicas. Y luego estamos nosotros, la posición del observatorio, el que consideramos que las desapariciones que hoy encontramos tienen la misma lógica que las desapariciones pasadas. Encontramos lógicas que rodean a las desapariciones que se repiten, pero que las características de las desapariciones que hoy tenemos no son exactamente las mismas que las que observábamos en las desapariciones clásicas, aunque efectivamente las lógicas que las rodean son similares. Aquí voy a aprovechar para hacer una publicidad a un libro que hemos coordinado Bárbara Lipain y yo, que sale ahora el 24 de junio sobre Disappearances in the Post-Transition Era, donde desarrollamos de alguna manera esta idea. Bueno, ¿cuáles son las lógicas de desapariciones que encontramos y que se repiten o que rodean las desapariciones que las rodeaban antes y las rodean ahora? Primero, la actuación clandestina, ¿no? El ocultamiento de las desapariciones, del paradero de las personas desaparecidas, que nos lleva a preguntarnos, bueno, eventualmente cuando alguien desaparece lo que se busca es ocultar el paradero y mantener en una situación de clandestinidad a la persona. Tanto ayer como hoy la clandestinidad están presentes, sin embargo en las desapariciones en México hoy lo que observamos es que estas prácticas clandestinas las desarrollan tanto agentes estatales como agentes no estatales y muchas veces agentes estatales y no estatales en colaboración. Por otra parte, la segunda lógica es la lógica que llamamos de población desechable. Quien desaparece socialmente es estigmatizado como parte de un grupo peligroso. En el caso de México, hoy básicamente la idea que prevalece o la representación de las personas desaparecidas las vinculan con actividades criminales, con ser parte de grupos que se dedican a actividades sobre todo vinculadas con la droga y con las organizaciones criminales vinculadas con la droga. Es decir, la persona desaparecida es estigmatizada como criminal y esto genera de alguna manera una revictimización de las mismas, culpabilizándolas de lo que sucede. Por otra parte, la otra lógica es la de la pérdida ambigua por parte de las familias. Las familias de las personas desaparecidas en un primer momento están desorientadas, viven una incertidumbre muy fuerte, tienen miedo, son dejadas y marginadas por sus familias y sus comunidades y tardan bastante tiempo en poder organizarse y sobreponerse a esta situación y comenzar a buscar justicia. En México hoy tenemos más de 80 grupos de familiares buscando a sus seres queridos, pero si esto llevó aproximadamente una década este proceso de organización. Y la cuarta lógica es la lógica económica, que está vinculada con una dinámica de economía política. Detrás de las desapariciones en México observamos hoy que mucho tiene que ver con procesos por o control territorial por grupos de crimen organizado o por búsqueda de control territorial por parte del Estado y también casos de reclutamiento forzado y esclavitud de personas que desaparecen por diferentes redes criminales. Y anteriormente, en las desapariciones clásicas, lo que se veía era mucho más mayor vinculación con empresas y la desactivación de la representación sindical en empresas. Bueno, ¿qué observamos en México? Estas lógicas de desaparición se insertan en un régimen de violencia. Sabemos que donde hay mayor violencia aumentan las violaciones de derechos humanos. No es la excepción en México. Y esto nos llevó a preguntarnos acerca de cuáles eran las características del régimen de violencia, de las reglas a partir de las que se articulaba el uso, el acceso y la circulación de la violencia. Y lo que encontramos es que opera en este momento un régimen de violencia en el que estas desapariciones se dieron en el marco de un régimen de violencia en que hay casos en que los perpetradores son agentes estatales de los tres niveles del Estado. En otros casos, los perpetradores son miembros de organizaciones criminales. Y en otros casos, los perpetradores son individuos que eliminan y ocultan a una persona, sobre todo en casos de violencia de género, y esta persona es desaparecida. Pero en muchos casos actúan de manera conjunta y en colusión. Entonces, las redes, las relaciones de violencia son mucho más complejas y esto lo distingue de alguna manera de los mecanismos de lo que se había denominado terrorismo de Estado en los casos de las dictaduras militares del Cono Sur. Y sin embargo, estas desapariciones se dan en entornos de democracias electorales y esto genera diferencias interesantes. Por una parte, las familias en este entorno se manifiestan y han logrado, y las familias y las organizaciones de la sociedad civil han logrado avances en la materia. Se aprobó una ley general sobre desaparición forzada y por particulares y del Sistema Nacional de Búsqueda de Personas, que no puede destacarse, no puede dejar de destacarse. Sin embargo, en esta ley lo que creó fue, por una parte, comisiones de búsqueda para buscar personas desaparecidas de manera desformalizada, y por otra parte, oficinas especiales o fiscalías especializadas en desaparición que realizan la persecución penal. En vista de esto, en nuestra segunda etapa de trabajo en el observatorio, y ya con esto termino, lo que hicimos es un análisis de las diferentes respuestas estatales que a partir de este nuevo marco jurídico se habían presentado. Y lo que observamos es que en relación con las fiscalías especializadas, lo que predomina es la deficiencia en la investigación criminal y sobre todo el requerimiento del impulso de las familias y muchas veces de que las familias hagan actividades de investigación, las familias de las personas desaparecidas hagan actividades de investigación, lo que es una carga extraordinaria para ellas. Por otra parte, respecto a las comisiones de búsquedas que se crearon, lo que observamos es que son nuevas instituciones, con todo lo que esto implica, ¿no? El desarrollo institucional con bajos recursos, pero que sin embargo son un espacio que las familias de las personas desaparecidas consideran más cercano, ¿no? Y hay una mayor apropiación. En relación con el acceso a la información, lo que observamos es que las políticas de acceso a la información respecto de las desapariciones es muy difusa. En nuestro trabajo estuvimos un año requiriendo acceso a información de las fiscalías para saber la cantidad de casos que llevaban y poder acceder, por ejemplo, en los poderes judiciales a las sentencias sobre el tema realizadas. Y finalmente, en los poderes judiciales, lo que encontramos en los poderes judiciales locales, esto es de los estados, encontramos pocas sentencias y sentencias sin una narrativa sobre el tema, ¿no? Que únicamente identifican responsables inmediatos, pero que no hay una construcción, una búsqueda de verdad, una búsqueda de reparación en relación con el tema. Y ya para finalizar, a mí me gustaría destacar esto, que las desapariciones que observamos en este momento en México se producen en un entorno de alguna manera típico. No estamos ante una dictadura o un gobierno autoritario y tampoco ante un conflicto armado, y donde en este sentido convive un régimen de violencia multidireccional con un régimen político que podríamos calificar de democracia electoral y donde las demandas de derechos humanos interactúan y están permanentemente haciendo demandas al Estado y buscando alternativas para encontrar a todas las personas que nos faltan y que, sin embargo, todavía las respuestas institucionales, las respuestas estatales ante las desapariciones son fragmentadas y ocupan un lugar muy periférico en la política estatal. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Karina. Con esto pasamos ahora a la presentación de la doctora Bárbara Frey. Adelante.
Gracias, Agnieszka y Karina, gracias por... So thank you, Agnieszka. Thanks to the Watson Center. We're delighted to share information about what we've learned about disappearances in Mexico. As Karina amply pointed out, there's a crisis of disappearances in Mexico. By the government's own accounting, there's more than 88,000 persons disappeared, and the majority of those since 2006. Despite enforced disappearances being one of the most universally condemned human rights crimes, this is an ongoing crisis in Mexico. It's disappearances are a crime that is a continuing violation, and it is particularly cruel because it the victims include the family members who also suffer grave harm because they don't know what has happened to their loved ones. So as Karina talked about, we formed the observatory in 2015, and we've been working in partnership by dividing up the work of analyzing available sources of information and trying to understand patterns that help us to understand this phenomenon. So our partners in Mexico analyzed the files of non-governmental organizations and court proceedings, and the University of Minnesota team working from a distance used online resources since that's what was available to us. So since we started our own analysis of press in 2017, we've had more than 40 student researchers who participated by reading and coding articles, analyzing the results for patterns, and interviewing journalists and family members of the disappeared and other human rights advocates. The articles we've coded were between the years 2009 and the middle of 2018 in four different states. Guerrero, Jalisco, and the two northern border states of Coahuila and Nuevo León. And we've used that information to complement the information that our Mexican colleagues are getting from other data sources. So this is the methodology that we've used. We had 226 variables, which tried to, which fell into these categories, having to do with the nature of the articles and the publication and the journalist, victims, what we could learn from the article about the victims, what we could learn about the events, what we could learn about the perpetrators and outcomes, and the state response. So in this overwhelming slide, you get a sense of the database, which is downloadable from our website, which I'll give you the link to in a second. And for each line on the database represents one individual disappeared person. So we coded the by case name. If we would find a person's name in a news article, we would search for all the articles concerning that case. And then each column is a variable. So we only used, in the public database, we've only used first names, not surnames, to, even though these are from public sources, we didn't want to make it easy for anyone to be using this collected information to do any harm or further harm to the victims or their families. So this is a close-up of to give you a sense of one of the variables, which in this case is the occupation of the victim. So if you see on the this side, you'll see 999 is coded for no information available. So there's a lot of 999s in the entire database because of the lack of information. But there was some information reported on occupation. And so for instance, number 7 coded here would relate to craft and related trade workers, which is in our coding manual. And both the database and the coding manual are in Spanish and English and fully available to download on the website for anyone interested in doing further research. So this is the website. I'm not gonna go there for lack of time, but I invite you all to do so, or someone could throw that in the chat and people can do it and take a look at the website. At the website, we did this instead of publishing a print report, We have background on the problem of disappearances in Mexico, stories about journalists and the practice of reporting on disappearances, and then our key findings from our analysis, which I'll briefly cover in this presentation. So in terms of our overview of our database, as I suggested, the time period was 2009 to mid-2018. We had 651 named victims that we found in four different states. You can see Coahuila and Nuevo León on the border and Jalisco and Guerrero on the Pacific coast. And these were from 227 separate media outlets. And one of the initial looks is at the top five municipalities where disappearances were reported by the press. And while they tended to focus in urban areas or urban centers, we also found disappearances reported in many municipalities, which suggests the generalized nature of the problem throughout these four states and Mexico in general. So one of the, this is a slide showing the number of disappearance reported in the press. So the orange line is the total cases by year. And then each line is a breakdown of the state. So you can see in certain states like Nuevo León, the peak of reporting was in 2011, which was when the height of the disappearances problem was at its worst in the state. Other states like Guerrero, which was the site of the 43 students who were missing, which by the way is not in our database, so it doesn't skew all of the press reporting numbers. But there were less reports until after that 2014 disappearance when there was more awareness of disappearances. And so you see a peak here. And similarly in Jalisco, the yellow line, there were fewer disappearances in the times that they were taking place in northern Mexico, but they got much higher in 2012 and have stayed high because Jalisco is a very high disappearance state. One of the initial observations that we make here is that there's very thin reporting, right? There are very few cases reporting, considering that in each of these states, there are thousands of disappearances that have been reported. And yet there's only the highest number of cases in this time period is in Jalisco, and it's about 200 cases reported in the press. So the press reporting on individual cases is pretty minimal. We did want to emphasize that there are two things I want to emphasize. First is that it's dangerous to be a journalist in Mexico, and we understand both the danger and the enormity of the crisis. In about this same time period, between 2005 and 2018, 21 journalists themselves were disappeared in Mexico, as well as many more who were killed. It's one of the, I think next to Iraq, it's had the highest number of journalists killed over the past decade. And we also want to emphasize that this kind of underreporting of individual victims in cases is not unique to Mexico. We see this problem in the United States in, for instance, gun violence of in urban centers. Very rarely are the victims profiled or reported or their cases followed on an individual basis. But we still felt that we could find useful information from what was reported in the press. And so this is a brief analysis of that. So first, what was reported about the victims? And as Karina suggested from the other databases, the predominance is male disappearances. In 74% of reported cases were male, 25% were female, or a few trans. And then the top occupations that were reported were sales and service workers, professionals, students, and then plant and machine operators. This may be skewed by our further analysis, which is on newsworthiness of victims, and which I will discuss later, where professionals and students in particular are overreported in cases because they tend to be more sympathetic victims. So here's a chart that basically shows the same thing I just described. The victims were young, so overall 33% of all the victims, men and women, were between 18 and 25. And most male victims were 18 to 25, but women and girls skewed younger, just like Karina mentioned from our other investigations. Most victims reported to remain disappeared. This graph shows the percentages in yellow that represent victims who were reported still to be disappeared in combination with cases where there was no further outcome reported in the case. We chose to group those two categories because basically the data tells us the same thing. We don't know what happened to the victims. So what about the perpetrators? Well, we categorized the perpetrators as state actors, private actors, and those acting in collusion between state and private actors. So the collusion is in the orange, private actors are the blue, state actors are in the red, and unknown is in the yellow. So you always see that there's a predominance of no information reporting, but when perpetrators were reporting, it's interesting to see a fairly high reporting rate of collusion between state and private actors, and especially in the state of Nuevo León, a high number, 38%, where private actors were identified as the perpetrators. The suspected perpetrators varied by state, and you can see in the border states, Losetas were primarily reported as the perpetrators. In Jalisco, Cartel de Nueva Generación was reported most frequently, and in Guerrero, the press almost never reported a specific perpetrator, which might indicate a level of fear on their part. So what was reported on the response? Oops. Sorry. And well, again, not very much. The state, as we know, there's a lot of impunity in the country, which is one of the causal correlations to these human rights problems. And the press reports underscore this high level of impunity where little action is taken. So you can see in this slide that in 71% of reported cases, there was no mention even of a search. And in 89% of cases, there was no arrest or charge. And in 92% of the cases, no sentencing. So let me briefly touch on our conceptual findings, and then we can take a few questions. So we wanted to learn what we could from this database about what the press reports tell us conceptually. And our analysis starts from the recognition that the media plays an important role in how the public understands human rights violations and in its role in promoting justice, institutional reform, and reparations. So the importance of the media cannot be exaggerated in this kind of situation. So in light of that, we found two major areas of observation. One is the spot news reporting. So we found a tendency of the press to report on each disappearance as a single criminal event and not as an ongoing human rights violation. And this tendency to use spot news, which is also called a nota roja in Spanish, tells us that it doesn't really signify the human rights impacts or implications of these crimes. So here's an example of spot news. In this article, which is a brief, it's called a police brief in a newspaper in Guerrero, and we find that there is, listing disappearances of three different individuals with no reported connection to each other or any more information besides the location and date of each disappearance. So these three cases on the 20th of August, this person is 20-year-old, three people were found disappeared. I won't go through the details. In the same article, just lower down in the article, you can see there are two other news pieces. The top one is about a robbery and the bottom one is about a car crash, all in the same article. So this kind of format of listing disappearances along with other criminal matters indicates that it's just a basic crime, run-of-the-mill crime. The second conceptual finding that we found in our study has to do with the newsworthiness of disappearance victims. And what we have looked at is there's a theoretical studies that deal with this concept of newsworthiness that use a theory called the rarity theory. And so the idea is that rare cases receive more press coverage. And the types of rare cases include unusual events. So here, unusual events tend to be more than one victim, or a serious or a kind of notorious case, right? So the first, if we look at unusual events, we find that group disappearances receive much higher media attention overall in Mexico. And we did this analysis by looking at the top five reported events with the highest number of press articles in each of the four states that we reported. So this is an example of 11 police officers who disappeared in one event in Apodaca in Nuevo León in 2011. And this article received 14 different news articles, which is double the average of the articles per group case. So the coverage was also very thorough. It included detailed information about the state's response, investigations and trials, and the location of the bodies when they were found in 2016. Another type of unusual events have to do with the degree of seriousness. For example, when cases involve gruesome crimes, such as the disappearance and murder of Azucena, Luis, and their baby in Guerrero in 2018. Azucena was decapitated, Luis was murdered and his body burned, and the baby was found alive in the car in a cooler. And this case generated 15 articles, which is more than double the average articles in these cases. Another set of cases that received a high number of articles correspond to the notion of the ideal victim. These are victims who are sympathetic or high profile. So one example is this case of Ranferre Hernandez, who is a high profile former PRD politician and a social justice activist who was found disappeared along with his family in Guerrero. And in October 2017, they were eventually found dead and their bodies were burned. And this case generated 11 press articles, which is 6 more than the average. And others, sympathetic victims. Here's the case of Johan Gao, who was a 3-year-old boy who disappeared. Coverage was very high, given that disappearances of children this young are rare. It also received attention from authorities in Coahuila, evidenced by official searches and the activation of an Amber Alert. So this case generated 16 articles, 11 more. I'm wrapping up here, Agnieszka. So let me just go to the last finding, which is that when families of the disappeared were involved in their cases and were visible, there were far more press articles about the disappearances. So for instance, the disappearance of Juan Hernandez in February 2011 in Nuevo León was covered by twice as many articles as another federal police officer who disappeared in the same event. So because his mother was very visible as an activist in the case. So we found that to be a very important finding. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Barbara and Karina. As usual, we have a little time and a lot to share and discuss. I will move forward with the questions. We have a couple of minutes for both of you to answer. I have 2 questions. One is in Spanish, one is in English. In English, it has the phenomenon of disappearances of persons worsened since the election of President López Obrador. I ask this because up until 2019, you mentioned you had registered approximately 53,000 people disappeared, and now the number has increased. So that's the first question. And the question in Spanish I have, los medios de comunicación que realizan reportajes de investigación siguen siendo medios alternativos o esto ha sido retomado por medios masivos? Another question para Karina. ¿Cuándo saldrá tu libro, el libro que has mencionado? ¿Cuándo se va a publicar? And these are the questions we have up to now, and feel free to take the mic and answer.
Y quieren, bueno, rápidamente, en mi opinión, no empeoró la situación de desapariciones durante el gobierno de López Obrador. Se mantuvo, la crisis de desapariciones no se redujo. No podría decir que haya empeorado, sino que pues, se mantuvo. Estas 33,000 desapariciones que encontramos también tiene que ver con que se están actualizando los sistemas, cambió la forma de recuperar información y entonces no sabemos cuántos de estos números en realidad tienen que ver con subregistro que ahora se está registrando. Entonces, yo lo que diría es, desde 2007 vemos una tendencia ascendente y a partir de 2011 se observa un nivel muy alto y prácticamente no hemos podido bajar de ese nivel de desapariciones. Respecto de la militarización, creo que la militarización venía desde antes, o sea, parte del problema es que en 2006 con la denominada guerra contra el narco, el narcotráfico se consideró como un enemigo interno y se militarizó el combate, entre otras cosas, porque los Zetas tenían armamento militar y eran un grupo desertor del propio ejército. Entonces esto llevó a una escalada de violencia y también la militarización continúa, ¿no? Creo que en este punto no hubo grandes cambios en la política respecto de las desapariciones, en la medida, no diría que empeoró, lo que diría es que no hubo cambios significativos, aunque se habla de una estrategia de paz, ¿no? Pero sin embargo, lo que vemos es despliegue militar. Entonces, esta es mi respuesta a esto. No empeoró, se mantuvo. Por otra parte, el libro es de Oxford University Press. Lo editamos Barbara Fry, Lee Payne y yo. Y sale el 24 de junio. Lo pueden encontrar en Oxford University Press y se llama Disappearances in the Post-Transition Era in Latin America y trabajamos el caso de México y otros casos.
Gracias, Cari. I will add another question for you, Barbara, that just came in. Said, I would like to ask about the data presented by Barbara, in particular, at least two new stories from Chilapa, a town that suffers a very terrible situation. Were you able to find any data on context slash situations that receive more coverage beyond individual cases? I think it relates to the other one as well.
Yeah, that's a great question. Okay, so as far as, I just wanted to add to the answer about the situation post AMLO, that one of the new developments is that we have this national search process, which also includes a more sophisticated accounting of the numbers. So we have a better sense of the numbers, or there is at least more information that's available to the public that for many years from, you know, we didn't know. And that's kind of why we started our project, is because there was so little known that we wanted to figure out what we could and make that available. Now, in terms of the press coverage, I wanted to highlight the fact that there are collectives of investigative journalists who've done an extraordinary job of uncovering human rights violations, including disappearances. So there's A Donde Van Los Desaparecidos and Zona Docs and Periodistas de APA, for example, who have done very courageous and important reporting that has helped us to understand, for instance, what actually happens to disappeared people. And they've documented mass graves across the country, et cetera. So, but the mass media, we were looking at print media. So we were not looking obviously at television or radio, which has a whole different feel in Mexico. The mass media tends to do these nota roja. They don't, except for occasional really individual journalists who do a much better job. And then finally, there's much more press reporting on the situation of disappearance, but not individuals. We had to make that distinction, but it still lacks information, right? We don't know who the disappeared are, you know, what their lives are like, or what happened to them.
Perfect. Thank you so much to both of you. Thank you for all our participants in this session today. Unfortunately, time is up and we have to close. We have some more questions, which I will forward to you later. And also I would like to thank our interpreter, Patty Gutierrez. There are some messages thanking you, Patty, for your service today. And thank you to Adam and Seth and Kate from the Center of Human Rights and Humanitarian Studies and the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies for co-sponsoring this webinar. And thank you all for being here today, and hope to see you for our next series.